Listen and enjoy the Deep Red Radio Pod.
Hallo liebe Hörerinnen und Hörer, ihr hört jetzt gleich mein Interview, welches ich auf dem Hardline Film Festival 2019 mit Regisseur, Produzent und Verleiher Julian Richards geführt habe. Ich wollte noch ein paar Worte vorneweg machen, denn das Interview ist rein technisch nicht ganz so gelungen, wie ich es mir erhofft hatte. Ich hatte auch schon überlegt, dort eine andere Aufbereitungsform zu wählen, indem ich die Fragen, die ich gestellt habe, einfach nur im Nachhinein nochmal übersetzt im Deutschen vorlese und dann seine Antworten jeweils reinschneide. Habe mich dann aber doch dagegen entschieden, weil ich hoffe, es ist trotzdem noch von der Aufnahmequalität in Gänze zumutbar. Wir sind halt ab und zu mal unterbrochen worden, das konnte ich so ganz gut rausschneiden, bis auf eine Stelle, die habe ich so original belassen, ist auch ganz lustig und vielleicht auch nicht unwichtig, weil er dann später im Interview nochmal auf genau diese Unterbrechung Bezug nimmt, deswegen ist es hier drin geblieben. Wie gesagt, bitte entschuldigt die Tonqualität an manchen Stellen, wenn da im Hintergrund vielleicht mal gestaubsaugt wird oder irgendwie was anderes Lautes ist. So ist es manchmal in den Hotels. Der Julian Richards war derjenige, dem das Director Spotlight in diesem Jahr gewidmet war. Und das hieß, dass drei Filme aus seinem Oeuvre gezeigt wurden, nämlich sein Debüt Darklands aus dem Jahr 96, sein wahrscheinlich bekanntester, berühmtester und auch erfolgreichster Film The Last Horror Movie und mit im Wettbewerb vertreten einer seiner beiden neuesten Filme, der Reborn. Und ich habe im Gegensatz zu den anderen Interviews, die ich geführt habe, die waren ja mit Tom Bocci und Maika Gallo zu ihren jeweiligen Wettbewerbsbeiträgen, hier gar nicht so sehr über den Film an sich sprechen können. Was zum einen daran lag, dass ich ein bisschen weiter ausholen wollte, was ja doch die etwas größere Vita von Julian Richards verglichen mit den anderen genannten begründete und andererseits ich auch ein bisschen schlechtes Zeitmanagement betrieben habe und hier hinten raus ein wenig abrupt abbrechen musste, weil dann der Slot, der mir gegeben war, dann leider schon zu Ende war, zu zwei, drei Fragen und ein etwas runderes finde ich hier ausblieben. Bitte entschuldigt dies. Vielleicht hören wir das auch an irgendeiner Stelle nochmal nach. Vielleicht, wenn dann Reborn auch hier einen Verleih gefunden hat. Noch ein paar Worte zum Film. Dieser ist einer, der 2018 gedreht wurde. Und in dem Jahr hat Julian Richards noch einen zweiten Film gemacht. Das war also für ihn persönlich ein sehr arbeitsreiches. Nachdem er eine ganze Weile sich zumindest als Regisseur zurückgehalten hatte, nämlich 6 Jahre, was aber nicht bedeutet, dass er auf der faulen Haut rumlag, nämlich neben den familiären Neuerungen mit der Geburt seiner Töchter hat er sich vor allen Dingen auch ziemlich doll auf seine Tätigkeit als Verleiher konzentriert. Wie es dazu kam, dass er jetzt neben der Profession als Regisseur auch noch in der Distribution tätig ist, hört ihr im Interview. Deswegen war es halt auch für ihn was ganz Besonderes, wieder einen Film zu drehen mit Reborn, der auch wieder, das hatte er schon mal, nicht in Großbritannien gefertigt wurde, sondern in den USA. Und Reborn ist im Prinzip ein ultra-low-budget-Film, wo man ganz ehrlich sagen muss, dass man diesem auch angesehen hat. Und das sollte man bei der Bewertung des Ganzen auch immer im Hinterkopf haben. Er entstand in einer ganz geringen Drehzeit von nur gut 2 Wochen, wurde in Kalifornien gedreht und Julian Richards hatte auch relativ interessante Einblicke gegeben bei den Q&As, wie Zeit und auch Geld gespart wird, wenn man davon wenig hat. Es ist ganz gut zu sehen, wie wenn man verhindert, dass zwischen 2 verschiedenen Szenen, die eigentlich gar nicht zwingend miteinander zusammenhängen, aber die irgendwo in einer zeitlichen Abfolge passieren, man einfach nicht mehr umbaut und diese mehr oder weniger zusammenschneidet, um die gleiche Einstellung zu benutzen. In dem Film ganz gut zu sehen, wenn zum Beispiel eine Person ein Haus verlässt und gleichzeitig eine andere kommt, ohne dass jetzt hier nochmal großartig umgebaut werden muss. In dem Fall sind das ein Polizeikommissar, der ermittelt in verschiedenen Mordfällen und eine Schauspielerin, die besten Tage ihrer Karriere schon hinter sich hat. Der erste wird gespielt von Michael Poray, ziemlich bekannter Name, vor allen Dingen im B- und auch C-Bereich, der ja damals seine Karriere steil begann mit Straßen in Flammen oder Eddie and the Cruisers oder das Philadelphia-Experiment, dann aber ganz viel auch gedreht hatte in dem vor allen Dingen Action- und Horror-Bereich, der so Richtung Krabbelkiste tendiert, ganz viel gemacht, auch mit zum Beispiel Uwe Boll in fast jedem zweiten Film von diesem zusammengearbeitet, Postal Seed, Tunnel Rats, Far Cry, aber auch hin und wieder mal, was ich ja besonders dann schön finde, auch kleinere Rollen in größeren oder zumindest, sagen wir mal, gehaltvolleren Filmen findet, wie Virgin Suicides, Der Mandant oder halt auch Bone Tomahawk. Die genannte andere ist Barbara Crampton, die ähnlich, zumindest in Fankreisen, ein hohes Ansehen hat durch ihre frühen Rollen in Reanimator oder From Beyond oder Castle Freak oder dem Original Puppet Master, deren Karriere dann auch so ein bisschen stockte. Sie hat viel Fernsehen gemacht und wurde dann so vor 10 Jahren von Filmemachern, die selber Filmfans waren, wieder entdeckt, wieder besetzt und hat seitdem wieder so einen kleinen zweiten Karrierefrühling erlebt. In so Produktionen auch wie Your Next oder Lords of Salem. Und zum Beispiel hat sie dann auch mit Michael Paray in einer von den vielen Fortsetzungen von Puppet Master, nämlich Puppet Master The Little Reich, also quasi den letzten oder vorletzten Beitrag zusammen mitgespielt. Von daher ist der Film auf der Ebene schon relativ interessant und bietet damit auch viele Schauwerte auf der Meta-Ebene. Auch solche Fakten, dass der im Haus des Produzenten Brian Usner, der zum Beispiel den Reanimator 2 gedreht hat und noch andere Genre-Produktionen wie Return of the Living Dead 3 und was noch nicht alles noch dabei war, und man in dem Haus, was als im Film dann als das Haus von der von Barbara Crampton gespielten Dame wirkt, sind halt alle möglichen Filmposter und Verweise auch noch vorhanden, so dass man dort als Filmfan eine Menge im Hintergrund zu entdecken hat. Jetzt sollte ich euch noch verraten, worum es geht bei Reborn, bevor das Interview dann wirklich losgeht. Es geht von der Thematik her um eine Frau, Barbara Crampton, die ein Kind zur Welt bringt. Dieses ist leider eine Totgeburt und im Leichenschauhaus passiert dann aber das, dass durch einen nächtlichen Blitzeinschlag bei einem Gewitter das Baby wieder zum Leben erweckt wird. Nicht unbemerkt von einem, etwas creepy angehauchten Pfleger, der das Kleine dann mit zu sich nach Hause nimmt und unter Isolation die nächsten 16 Jahre aufzieht, bis diese das dann mit circa ihrem 16. Geburtstag ihre Lebenssituation ganz schön hinterfragt, von zu Hause ausbricht, es damit den ersten Toten gibt und sich auf den Weg macht, ihre wahre Herkunft zu ermitteln, ihre Mutter ausfindig macht, die mittlerweile eine halb gescheiterte Schauspielerin ist, mittleren Alters, sich damit rumschlägt, dass die Rollen nur noch sehr träge kommen und wenn dann auch keine guten mehr sind und sich eher mit Schauspiellehrerjobs über Wasser hält, als wirklich selber noch aktiv zu sein. Und der Film ist quasi eine Zusammenführung von Mutter und Tochter, die allerdings natürlich, wie man vermuten kann, unter keinem guten Stern steht und auf deren Weg der eine oder andere Tote, die Tote links und rechts liegen bleibt, was wiederum dann den von mir erwähnten ermittelnden Kommissar, gespielt von Michael Paray, auf den Plan ruft. Und ihr merkt es vielleicht an der Beschreibung, das ist jetzt in dem Sinne jetzt nicht irgendwie ein Slasher, wo sie zum Messer greift und auf diese Art und Weise die Leute, die ihr im Weg stehen, aus dem Weg räumen. Nein, sie hat durch diesen Blitzeinschlag, als sie wieder erweckt worden ist, so gewisse telekinetische Kräfte, kann also Strom für sich gewinnbringend einsetzen. Dabei wird natürlich schnell ersichtlich, woher der Film seine Inspiration nimmt. Und da könnten jetzt so einige Werke von Stephen King und die darauf basierenden Verfilmungen aufgezählt werden. So was bisschen was auf Telekinese beruht und den Kräften, die damit verbunden sind, also irgendwo halt quasi Firestarter oder Dead Zone, so ein bisschen auch Christine, aber natürlich vor allem Carrie, wo neben dem telekinetischen Aspekt natürlich auch noch diese Mutter-Tochter-Konstellation eine große Rolle spielt und eine sehr ähnliche ist. Natürlich gibt es auch noch andere Filme, wo diese Art von Macht gebraucht wird, Scanners, und was die mit den genannten auch alle einhaben, dass die alle so in den, naja, Ende 70er, 80er Jahren entstanden, und das ist halt auch irgendwo die Zeit der Reborn huldigt, zumindest was die filmischen Produkte angeht. Das gelingt in dem Sinne auch mit den Darstellern und den ganzen Hintergründen ganz gut. Dabei ist halt trotzdem, auch wenn er da aufgrund des schon genannten fast nicht vorhandenen Budgets natürlich, was heißt natürlich, leider in keinster Weise rankommt, aber er trotzdem ganz guten Unterhaltungsfaktor bietet, bei dem man aber Abstriche machen muss durch halt die knappen Mittel. Trotzdem wäre es schön, wenn Reborn auch bald hier veröffentlicht wird. Bis dahin wünsche ich euch viel Spaß mit dem Interview, und vielleicht seht ihr ja auch in der Zwischenzeit den Deathsember, also die Horrorfilm-Anthologie über den Advent, über Weihnachten, wo auch Julian Richards einen von 24 Beiträgen beigesteuert hat. Dear listeners, this is Max from the Deep Red Radio podcast, and we are here at the Hardline Film Festival. Sitting right next to me, director, producer and distributor Julian Richards. Thanks for having us and being on the show. Let's start with the beginning before we come to your movies, because you are standing below the director spotlight here at the Hardline Festival this year with your movies Darklands, Last Horror Movie and the new Reborn. But let's go back to the beginning. I've read that your big inspiration was not a movie director when you were a teenager, but your uncle. And he sacrificed his rugby career for being the king of Wongo Wongo. Can you tell the audience this little interesting story?
Yeah, yeah. This was an incredible thing, actually, because he got capped to play for Wales in rugby, and you know that's a big honor for any family to have a national team player in your family. But he was also involved in entertainment. This was in the 50s, and how he would be involved in entertainment, he was like an aqua diver, and his nickname, he had a very good physique. So his nickname on the rugby pitch was Tarzan, and he became sort of known as the Welsh Tarzan. In fact, he received a cease and desist from a US film company saying that he wasn't allowed to use that name. But it wasn't him that was using it. It was actually the Welsh press. But he heard that they were casting for a Tarzan film in the US, and because of his nickname, and because he really aspired to sort of act, he thought that he would go and see if he could audition for the part. And he got through to the last five, and I think, you know, didn't quite make it to the final part. But there was another film at the time being made. This was in Florida, and this film were casting all the Tarzan rejects. and it was the Wild Women of Wongo. So he got the part of King Wongo in one of the worst films ever made. I grew up with him living in the US and coming back to visit his family sort of every other year or so. And every time he came back with amazing stories, of working in films. And occasionally we'd see him on TV in Last of the Mohicans. There was a TV series that he was played a part in, and that sort of made me as a kid realize that despite the fact that I was from a sort of a Welsh working class background, that a career and a life my uncle had was obtainable.
So his career in the movie business was a short one, but yours started. You made some short movies when you were a teenager, and then you went to film school in Great Britain and later also in the US, I think, and directed a lot of shorts. And then you worked for Amblin in the yeah. early 90s. How was working with Steven Spielberg?
Yeah, it was a dream job come true, really, because the film that got me into filmmaking, when I decided to become a director, it was Jaws. And I made a lot of Super 8 shorts. I went to Bournemouth Film School, and then I went to the National Film School. And the first thing I did with my film student shorts when I graduated was go to LA and have a screening, and inviting agents to the screening. And I ended up with an agent, Michael Lewis. And I had a project that was based on a book that a friend of mine had written and had published. It was called Calling All Monsters. Mm-hmm. The author of the book, my friend, is Chris Westwood. And I sort of developed that into a treatment. And my agent set me up with a meeting with Amblin. And about 3 weeks later, I got a call from my agent saying, well, Amblin love it, and it's going to go into development there. So you need to come back over to LA, and you're going to be working with Spielberg's team, and it could be a project that Spielberg is going to direct.
Was the movie ever made?
No. What happened was, this was in the time of Kathleen Kennedy and Frank Marshall. And after a year of developing, they left Amblin and were replaced with Walter Parks and Ellie MacDonald. And so the project got caught in turnaround, you know, that the new execs coming in just wanted to ditch everything that was previously in development. And so we got sort of frustrated at the end. But it was still an amazing experience. I'll never forget coming back from a club in London at 3 a.m. in the morning, pretty drunk, and the phone rang. And it was an Amblin executive on the phone. And he said, hey, Stephen wants to talk with you. Would you be ready in 15 minutes? And I think he was in Poland at the time shooting Schindler's List. I wasn't expecting this call. Actually, the call never happened. I got a call 15 minutes late. They'd, oh, Stephen's busy and blah, blah, blah. So I actually never met Steven Spielberg, and I never really got the chance to talk to him, but it was still, you know, to be in that position was very bizarre.
How important was this episode of your career for the next step, doing your first own movie, The Darklands, and directing the first time feature film?
Well, I started to write Darklands when I was in the National Film School, so that was probably the late 80s. So when my first attempt at a Hollywood career didn't work out, I came back to the UK and I directed a TV soap opera called Brookside in Liverpool. And I directed that for about 12 months. But at the same time, I was trying to raise finance to get Darklands made. And what I find is that often with getting a project into production, it's about timing. An opportunity comes along that you don't expect, you know, that changes everything. And in this case, it was the advent of the National Lottery, and you know, the fact that the government were using lottery money to invest in films.
Sorry, kannst du gucken, ob man die Tür dazu machen kann oder so? Ich weiß nicht, it's very loud.
Yeah.
It's always the problem with the. Yeah, the hotels.
It's like shooting a film. We call it Murphy's Law.
What can happen, happens.
Yes.
Okay. So we continue.
So, this was the, you know, previously, any money available for filmmaking in the UK is a little bit like Germany. You know, there's no way they're going to put government money into a horror movie. And in Wales, they would only put money into a film that was Welsh language. But with the National Lottery, they were not only interested in putting money into Welsh films that were English-speaking, but they would also entertain the idea of a horror film. So actually, Darklands became the first Welsh horror film.
The next one was The Silent Cry,
yeah,
I think. And yeah, it was totally different. We don't have time to speak about every movie in detail. And then was your last horror movie. Mm-hmm. Very different in another way, of course. And then was the Summer Scars.
Summer Scars.
Summer Scars. Yeah. That's the movie I have to confess, I haven't seen Darklands and Last Horror Movie yet. I'm looking for Darklands tomorrow, but I've seen Summer Scars, and it's always teased with it's kind of Stand By Me. Mm-hmm. But I think it's was more related to This Is England.
Yeah.
Do you know This Is England? It was shortly before released, and was Summer Scar influenced by This Is England?
Well,
also?
You know, there's
the boys and
there's a tradition in British filmmaking of social realism, and I think that after I made Last Horror Movie, which is a you know, sort of a mockumentary, obviously I used realism, available light, handheld camera. And scenes being shot in one shot for the whole scene, so it was real time. I did Summer Scars. I thought, well, I sort of like, even though it's not found footage, it's not a mockumentary, I wanted to use a similar technique.
Yeah,
I mean, the whole story takes place in a forest, daytime. So I didn't need any production design. I didn't need any lights, and I decided to shoot the whole film handheld, and that was part of the, you know, the budget of the film. But I just felt that. That would make it look and feel more real. The big challenge with Summer Scars was working with six young actors aged about 14 and 15, and shooting it in 3 weeks. We shot it in August, and I chose August because that was probably the most likely month for it not to rain.
Yeah.
And it rained every day.
Of course.
it's Murphy's Law again, yeah?
Yeah.
So it was it was difficult to pull off, but I spent a lot of time casting. And I also found a writer for the script. I mean, it was based on a real incident that happened to me as a kid. And I, like Last Horror Movie, I found a writer that was not a writer. He was actually a roofer from Wales, a builder of sorts, who had sort of a writing ambition. And his writing was just very authentic and very real. So it was really sort of going the Ken Loach kind of route, which is very traditionally British.
Okay. And then before you went back to America, was a documentary about Charles Dickens? Was it a documentary or?
Yeah, it was a documentary of sorts. It was like with Derek Jacobi, and it was retracing Charles Dickens's life through the locations that he wrote about in his books, but also locations that he used to you know, work in as a writer and travel to as an orator. So it was almost like a travelogue. I'd never read any of Dickens's books. I was sort of interested in him because of his background. You know, that he was actually his father was put in prison, and he was brought up as a kid attending the poorhouse. So he had, you know, effectively a very poor background. And in through his writing, he wrote about characters who were, you know, from that background, which was unusual in Victorian times because writers usually came from very privileged backgrounds and wrote about privileged people. So that was sort of my route into Dickens. And it was just a job that came along from a producer that respected me as a filmmaker and trusted that I could, you know, I do horror movies, but I can also do a documentary on Charles Dickens. So it was a different challenge. It was fun to do.
Yeah, and but with Shiver, you came back to the horror and to the US. Was the situation right for you? Was it a coincidence? What happened for you to do this step for a second try?
Well, Shiver was an extraordinary experience, primarily because of the writer-producer, a guy called Robert Weinbach. And Robert Weinbach was a sort of a producer that was working in the 70s. He produced a film called The Mutations. Mm-hmm. The American title was Freak Maker. He also did a film with Boris Karloff called Blind Man's Buff. The other title of that was Cauldron of Blood. But he actually hadn't produced a film for 30 years. Instead, what he'd done is he sort of developed a property portfolio in Hollywood. Now he wanted to come back to filmmaking, and he'd adapted a novel to a screenplay and was looking for a director. And actually, he saw Summer Scars, and it was Summer Scars that persuaded him to pursue me as a director. And he hired me to do, you know, to direct the film. And originally, we were set to shoot it in Canada, in Saskatchewan. And we were there for 5 weeks in pre-production. And 3 days before we started shooting, the finance fell through. So what we did is we moved the production to Portland, Oregon, and we shot it on half the budget that we originally intended. So it was quite a challenge. and quite a challenge to be working with a producer who also wrote the script and was on set every day. I used to hide behind my headphones and just say, "Oh, sorry, you know, I can't hear you, Robert. We've got a very tight schedule. We've got to move on to the next shot," you know, to get the film made. So it was very challenging, but I was getting to work. It was actually my first US film, and my dream had always been to work in Hollywood and to make American films. So this was the first opportunity, and I was working with John Jarrett from Wolf Creek and Daniel Harris from Halloween and Ray Dawn Chong and Casta Van Dien, all of whom were fantastic. You know, I was sort of a little intimidated about working with actors of that sort of stature, but they were all extremely humble and helpful and professional, and enabled me to get through what was a very tight schedule. And we shot that film in 18 days, and it was quite an ambitious film to be shot with that kind of schedule.
Yeah. And then you became more and more angry about the lousy distribution of your movies, and then you started through the roof with Jinga Films as a distributor, and then there was a break of directing for 6-7 years. It started with the infamous Serbian film. Can you give us a background about your work as a distributor? I've already heard it takes a lot of time, and you would like to do more as a director, but you need to make the money, and so you decided to force your own luck.
Yeah. This was a big decision for me. I think, you know, the older I got, the more I realized that you're going to make a film every, you know, 4 or 5 years if you're lucky, and the budgets, they're not going to get bigger, they're going to get smaller, and therefore your fees are going to get less and less. And, you know, I sort of looked into the future, and I just thought, there's no way that this is sustainable. I can't pay the mortgage with the kind of fee that you get from independent filmmaking as a director. Plus, I had a very frustrating experience with my films in sales and distribution. And Silent Cry was interesting because the budget for that was, we had more money than we needed. It was like £3 million. And my fee to direct it was like 100,000. And when that came along, I already had the script for Last Horror Movie ready to go, but I didn't have the money. And suddenly my director's fee landed in my bank account and I had the money. So I put all my own money into Last Horror Movie.
Yeah.
You know, they always say you should never put your own money into a film. And I would say completely the opposite. You know, that if you really believe in your own film, why would you expect anybody else to put money into it if you're not going to? You know, so I gambled. I put all the money into that film and I made it. But because it was my own money, I needed to make sure I got it back. So it was actually at that point that I decided to get into sales to protect my investment. And I didn't intend to become a sales agent, but it sort of snowballed. Because we were so successful with Last Horror Movie, the producers came to me and said, "Oh, could you have a go at selling my film?" And so we started off doing about 3 or 4 films a year. And we did films like The Wild Country, The Disappeared. And we were beginning to get a sort of a reputation of, oh, this new genre sales company, but not coming out of the US, coming out of the UK. That was unheard of. And we picked up a Serbian film. And that film made such an impression on the market that from that point on, the whole market knew who we were. So we just went from strength to strength. And now we're doing 15 films a year. And it takes up a lot of my time and energy. And this is time and energy that I used to sort of put into development, into coming up with ideas and working with writers and developing screenplays. But now a lot of that energy goes into acquiring and selling films. So it's a compromise, you know, it's a little frustrating, but knowledge is power. And what it has taught me is the business of film and the reality of the business of film. There's a lot of smoke and mirrors in the film industry, and nobody really knows, you know, how it works and what the true value is. But when you're a sales agent, you do. You're on the front line of the business. And it's actually enabled me. I mean, I think the reason why I made Reborn and Daddy's Girl was because I became a sales agent, not because I was a sought-after director.
Yeah, you speak the last few minutes. We are already in time trouble. About, of course, about Reborn. It was another experience you told us in the Q&A in shooting an ultra low budget movie in the US. Your friend Brian Usner was asking for a director for this movie, and you said, I'm ready, I do it. And then the experience for shooting 15, 18 days started. And, but it was, I think, another good one for you, working with famous actors like Barbara Crampton and Michael Paré. You told us Barbara Crampton was your idea to cast her.
Yeah.
Was it the same way with Michael Paré, or was he already in the cast?
I wasn't really that aware of Michael Paré when I was in pre-production for Reborn. We had a casting director, Valerie McCaffrey, and she was the one that suggested him. And then I realized who he was, you know, from Streets of Fire and Eddie and the Cruisers and the Philadelphia Experiment. And I thought, oh, yeah. And the first thing you do is when you come across somebody like that, you want to find out how easy they are to work with. So there was a guy from Arrow in the Head, John Fallon, that made a film with him recently. So he's a Facebook friend of mine. So I contacted John. I said, what's Michael like? And John said, he's fantastic.
Yeah.
So I just thought, yeah, let's go for Michael Paré. And he was so easy to work with, very supportive of the director, and a genuinely nice guy, very professional, and sort of has a methodical approach, because he's playing a cop investigating a crime. He would sort of structure the movements of his character through a scene. Like a robot, you know. It was like, okay, I'm going to be here. I'm going to crouch down here. I'm going to hold the piece of paper here. Then I'm going to sort of look up, and then I'm going to go over there. And it was like every little movement was pre-planned by him. What he was doing was basically informing me where I needed to be with the camera to get those moments.
Yeah.
And I've never really had an experience working with an actor that has that sort of detailed approach.
Yeah.
So, I'd work with Michael again anytime.
Okay, so I think we have to finish. Thank you very much for the interview.
Thank you.